please.
Please.
Yeah.
Well, you see, even from Sekuru, you are beautiful girls. Well, what an afternoon. My friend there was a little agitated about transformative achievements. I'll give you a joke before I make my actually written submission, because it's important for us as a nation, together with our development partners and international friends. A friend sent me a tweet yesterday, and they said, just sample this, because it tells you the state of hopelessness that we are faced with as a country. He said, I'm going to get my burial certificate and keep it in my pocket because by the time I die, this thing will be costing 1,000,000 shillings. What does that tell you? And yesterday, listening to President Ruto and talk about reality checks, this is the reality of our times. Incremental unemployment. But lest I go astray, let me thank you, Madam Annette Swander, Conrad Adenauer Stiftung. I'm not as good in German as my brother Raila Odinga, and you hear that. And also acknowledge Caroline Cantor, Deputy Director for European and International Cooperation. We set off for CAS, not the Kenyan CAS, we CAS, but KAS. The headquarters in Berlin, as you know, for extending to me this afternoon's invitation to speak to this distinguished assembly. And I thank you, my brother, my senior brother, Raila Molo Odinga, who is our party leader and our team leader, for agreeing to come and do the closing session. I know that this was organized at a very high level, and yesterday, Kenya Kwanza team may have, without them knowing, or whether it was deliberate, they managed to downgrade this very important assembly, because we are all in the printed. I assume before this time, these things go out, everybody will have said yes, we'll try and make time available. But if they are represented by my little sister Susan, and how you have grown, so be it. A closer examination, ladies and gentlemen, of the history of caste, they were here, which was founded on December 20th, 1955, by members of Germany's most successful political party, the Christian Democratic Union, CDU, is quite revealing. There was widespread agreement that no party, no man or woman would usurp democratic institutions ever again after the Second World War. There was widespread agreement that the best option for Germany was, quote unquote, a social market economy, a combination of free market capitalism, strong government regulation, and a comprehensive welfare state. The CDU's success can be attributed to two men, Konrad Adenauer, the party's first leader, and German Chancellor from 1949 to 1963, and whose legacy of freedom and democracy this wonderful foundation, Konrad Kass, bears. And Ludwig Erhard, widely regarded as the father of Germany's economic miracle, who served as Adenauer's economics minister before succeeding him as Chancellor in 1963. Combined with the United States stimulus package to Europe, which was then dumped, the Marshall Plan of 1948, which brought extensive investment to Europe, leading to the war-ravaged continent, indeed then West Germany's resurgence. The embrace of the transformative spirit of national dialogue was at the heart of Germany's post-World War II economic and political success, a model that is studied on a regular basis worldwide. Of course, I was asked to talk about transformative dialogue. I therefore consider today's topic that I've been asked to remark upon transforming a nation through dialogue, both timely and relevant in light of current events in our country. National dialogues are used as plural, also known as popular consultations or national conferences, bring together representatives from various political parties to discuss issues and challenges associated with the political transition. They have grown in popularity in recent decades as a means of achieving long-term peace and resolving key concerns such as ethnic and religious discord, as well as electoral mismanagement. These national dialogues can be used to build trust, increase participation, and forge consensus among national actors and the civil society in critical political, economic, and social decisions in the aftermath of an election or in the aftermath of a conflict. Guatemala, East Timor, Nepal, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, DRC, Niger, more recently, Mali and Kenya, Afghanistan, Iraq, and Yemen are among the countries that have conducted NDP's national dialogues in various forms. I have personally mediated national dialogues in Somalia, in South Sudan. In fact, in the case of Somalia, because their problem was ethnicity, clanism. They're all Muslim, all Muslim. But because they belong to small sub-clans, they have been at war with each other since the fall of Siad Barre in 1991. So I said the Mkambo wa Uko, and I had a clan, I had a Digli Mirifli, by chance to be able to get them. We did the best we can to negotiate the conflict with Somalia. And as you heard, even as we speak, our men and women in uniform, mainly men, are still in that neighboring country. I also was able to do some work in South Sudan and DRC. In fact, with regard to Burundi, with the late Mwalimu Julius Nyerere, we even imposed economic sanctions to try to get Warundi hawa na Rwanda waishi kama ndugu na dada. It didn't work. Then I realized economic sanctions don't actually work in the majority of these conflict situations. Of course, we did with mixed but mostly positive results. I can state unequivocally that I am a staunch supporter of this mode of discourse in order to prevent political conflict caused by ethnic and religious disharmony as well as electoral malpractice. You will recall after the fall of the Berlin Wall, Madam Annette, she's in your country, when President Reagan famously told Mr. Gorbachev in Moscow, "Mr. Gorbachev, bring down this war." And with it, the collapse of communism and the bipolar confrontation. And then, of course, the end of the Cold War. So the world had expected that we would then all reap what was referred to as a peace dividend, a man quote. But nobody knew that a new form of conflict was emerging based on religion. So we have now had hot wars based on what people believe. Now, Kenya's national conversations before and after independence arrive with both acrimony and compromise. From the European settlers who petitioned the British Secretary of State for colonies for representation in the Kenya administration in 1905, to the establishment of a legislative council, popularly known as Legico then, and its first all-European sitting on August 17, 1907. My brother Raila is very good with this history. I listened to him the other day when he was launching the Mau Mau Foundation, very detailed on how the Lunatic Express, among other things, brought about change. In 1954, Chief Colonial Secretary Walter Coote's commission investigated ways for Africans to elect their representatives As a result, the elections ordinance was amended to allow for the election of 8 African representatives from 8 electoral areas, with the first elections held in March 1957. The Lennox-Boyd Constitution, which increased African seats by 6 and provided for 12 specially elected members to be chosen by LegCo, was closely followed by the 1960 Lancaster House Constitutional Conference, which increased LegCo seats to 65. Set aside 33 for Africans. Does this ring a bell, ladies and gentlemen? We're still wrestling with the Supreme Court advisory on ability to bring into operation, operationalize the two-third gender rule. Lancaster II, held in 1962, was a more ambitious dialogue that resulted in establishment of a bicameral legislature comprising a lower house, House of Representatives, and an upper house, the Senate, with members elected by universal adult suffrage, as well as 7 regional assemblies, known then as Majimbo, to ensure maximum decentralization of government powers. During the third and final Lancaster House Constitutional Review Conference in February 63, an agreement for Kenya's independence was reached and came into effect on June 1st, 1963, a day we celebrate today as our Madaraka or Self-Determination Day. 6 months later, the Union Jack was lowered for the last time on Kenyan soil at midnight on December 12, 1963 at Uhuru Gardens, Nairobi, to great jubilation, and then the colors of our national flag unveiled. The dream of a free and independent nation was realized after 58 years of agonizingly acrimonious, ego-bracing, and time-consuming national dialogue between European settlers, Africans, Asians, Arabs, and the British government. From the scramble for Africa, which ironically took place in your wonderful country again, Berlin, a conference of 1895, the young protectorate evolved into a colony, and finally, an independent republic led by Africans. It is critical for this distinguished gathering to reflect on our history, even as the younger ones, the youth bunch. 70% of you in this room are age below 40, in fact 35. So we do these things in order to pass it over to you, so you know where we have come from. As a renowned Spanish-American philosopher George Santayana wrote in his book, The Life of Reason, the Life of Reason, as part of a series, Great Ideas of Western Man, Western Man, in 1905. I quote, "Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it." I wish you never repeat colonialism in our country. And Mr. Julius Malema is in town. He speaks with such passion about these things. Kenya's foundation has generally remained stable. But over time, political developments, including 24 amendments to the Independence Constitution, seriously undermined both our socio-economic and democratic processes. This included the dissolution of 7 Majimbos and the unification of the two houses to form the unicameral legislature in 1966, with a lot of serious political ramifications. The proclamation of a de jure one-party state by the National Assembly in June 1982 crowned it all. Autocratic rule, ethnic favoritism, and ethnic violence, particularly in the provinces of Nairobi, Coast, and the Rift Valley, and pervasive, indeed, systematic corruption. With the repeal of Section 2A of our country's constitution in 1991, Kenya entered a new phase of dialogue that culminated in the return to multipartism in 1992. At that conference, actually, I was the master of ceremony when we were decided to repeal. Mzee Moi said, he was amazing. He was such a mobilizer. he got all of us to say, we don't want any amendment, anything. And then he himself stood up and said, we must accept it. 6 years later, in November 1997, the minimum reforms package through the inter-parliamentary group, famously known as IPPG, carried out parliamentary reforms that included amending Public Order Act, CAP 56, to facilitate freedom of assembly, amending Section 33 of the Constitution so that the nomination of members of parliament was based on party strength and including the opposition's voice in the electoral body's makeup, the IEBC. This had hitherto been the president's exclusive prerogative. The historic victory of the National Rainbow Coalition, and my brother and I were key in this in the general election of December 2002, as well as equally significant concession of defeat by the presidential candidate of the ruling party, then our brother Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta, were, in my opinion, promissory products of the IPPG dialogue. I find it noteworthy that Kenyans were voted at the time the world's most optimistic people before and during the election. This was in accordance with Gallup International annual end-of-year survey, which involved interviews with over 67,500 people in 65 countries between November and December of 2002. However, the sentimental optimism was fleeting, as several agreements in our famous MOU between the coalition members, right, and we were signing. My brother Raila and I were on the rainbow side, and Mudi Awori, the late George Saitoti, and then Kibaki and Malwa, and you know that famous thing. Had that MOU document been respected, this country would have grown in leaps and bounds, would have avoided the outcome of the 2000 elections, for example. Was following a high court ruling, the recommendations made the Constitution of Kenya Review Commission, the CKRC, during the Bomas Constitutional Conference process, which favored a parliamentary system, were discarded. As a result, the public and a section of government officials became dissatisfied with the Mwai Kibaki administration. In a referendum held on November 21, 2005, Kenyans in 7 out of the 8 provinces overwhelmingly rejected the government-sponsored proposed new constitution. We then used to refer to it as the Kilifi draft. And we used to blame Attorney General Emeritus Amos Wako for that product. My brother Raila and I again were in the forefront in opposing it, and then the birth of the Orange Movement. Susan, you remember, that's how you came in now, when the country was divided between bananas and oranges. Over 1,200 Kenyans lost their lives in less than a month following the announcement of the results of 2007 presidential election, where my brother and Kibaki were tough contenders. I was among them. I used to say, "Ntapita katikati yao." Remember? I looked at these two giants, and I looked at myself as this David fellow, yeah, Kibaki huyu, Raila huyu, nitapita hapo katikati. And actually, to some extent, I did. Because that is how I was able to hold the two of them again. I became the nexus. I became the gum when the country was falling apart. It is particularly noteworthy that my party then, the Orange Democratic Movement Kenya, I used to say, in between me and Raila, we didn't even know how to divide the oranges. Yeah, because he kept a whole orange, and I kept an orange and a half. So, my own party then, that time, ODM Kenya, negotiated a post-electoral agreement with President Kibaki's PNU that helped stop the violence, at least, before my brother was brought on board by Kofi Annan. And you know, that was a serious conflict. That is what gave rise to Kenyan leaders going to The Hague. And you know them. And sometimes blame the wrong people. I've heard some of them blame Raila. And it's not right at all. I undertook an impossible task of trying to convince the United Nations Security Council to allow us to have Kenyan leaders tried here. And then Kenyans overwhelmingly through local radio stations used to say, don't be vague, go to the Hague. So, under the auspices of Kenya National Dialogue and Reconciliation Committee, Dr. Kofi Annan, the late brother and a real Pan-Africanist, the chairman of the panel of eminent African personalities, was tasked by the international community and of course the African leadership to help to resolve that political crisis. And on February 1st, 2008, he brought the late Mwai Kibaki and our brother Raila Odinga to the negotiating table, and where the four agenda items were agreed upon, namely, agenda one, immediate action to stop the violence and restore fundamental rights and liberties. Agenda item number two, immediate measures to address the humanitarian crisis and promote healing and reconciliation. Agenda item number three, how to overcome the political crisis. And agenda item number four, addressing the long-term issues, including undertaking constitutional, legal, and institutional reforms, land reform, tackling poverty and inequality, as well as combating regional development imbalances, tackling unemployment, particularly among the youth, consolidating national cohesion and unity, and addressing transparency, accountability, and impunity. That was a major agenda, and it was, to a large extent, achieved except for agenda item number four. And I must move faster. Agendas one, two, and three were faithfully carried out. And on February 28, 2008, President Kibaki and Right Honorable Odinga signed the agreement on the principles of partnership of the coalition government. In part, the preamble affirmed, I quote, there must be real power sharing to move the country forward and begin the healing and the reconciliation process. With this agreement, we are stepping forward together as political leaders to overcome the current crisis and set the country on a new path. This agreement is designed to create an environment conducive to such a partnership and to build mutual trust and confidence. We have agreed to enact the National Accord and Reconciliation Act, end of the quote, signed by the two leaders. Following the passage of the Kenya Constitution Review Act 208, Kenya Constitution Amendment Act 208, by Parliament, the process of drafting a new constitution, detailed in Agenda 4, began. 2 years later, and through a people-driven national dialogue, the Constitution of Kenya 2010 was finally promulgated to widespread acclaim at home, regionally, and internationally. Even though this living document is acknowledged as one of Africa's most progressive constitutions, there are still some aspects of its composition that, in its 13th year of existence, require serious deliberation. We in the Azimio la Umoja One Kenya Coalition hold the view that we cannot transform our beloved nation if we do not fundamentally address those Agenda 4 issues of 2008 and those concerns that we have outlined in the National Dialogue Committee, which have christened NADCO, and which I'm happily, as fate would have it, a co-chair. Our top priority, which was to address the cost of living, is demonstrated by the growing gaps in poverty and inequality brought about by harsh and burdensome taxes that take money out of people's pockets rather than putting it therein. And Susan, you're in the business trying to get people to put their money in their pockets. You haven't quite succeeded. Because this is where the issue is. Kenyans are crying, heavy burden of taxation. I have never seen a nation anywhere in the world which can develop on the basis of overtaxing its citizens, particularly during such economic reality. If anybody has one example in the world, yeah, we talked of the Marshall Plan and others, where you overtax your citizen in order to get out of depression, I will be happily able to listen to you. Despite the conflicting explanations. The primary causes of economic slow growth, indeed depression, are not solely attributable to global events, but rather economic mismanagement and endemic corruption. The last three presidential election results were strongly disputed, indicating that we have not addressed transparency, accountability, and impunity, particularly regarding our electoral management process. That is why we in Azimio la Umoja One Kenya Alliance Coalition insisted upon not only audit of 2022 general election, but a reconstitution of the Independent Electoral Boundaries Commission. We too in this NADCO process spoke to the deepening of our political gains by ensuring there will be fidelity to the Constitution as regards interference with political parties. The story that has been going on, merry-go-round in Jubilee, I'm a very key member of Azimio la Umoja One Kenya Coalition. It's disturbing. We have had to call a spade a spade. In these talks, we are not sparing any situation. And we are saying it is improper to disorganize Jubilee. Because by disorganizing Jubilee, you are trying to disorganize Azimio. And by implication, paying lip service to multi-party democracy. And this is our view. Our agenda items are the bipartisan talks at Bomas of Kenya, also included addressing the imbalance of public office appointments that are biased towards specific communities and poorly represented the aspirations of two-gender rule. This, we strongly argued, continued to undermine the ideals of national cohesion and unity. I would want, for example, very honest conversation about the recently concluded recruitment at the Kenya Defense Forces. Mukwanja and the rest of you in Parliament, please, if you want to heal this country, and I heard the President yesterday say 80% of recruitment to KDF now will be from National Youth Service, but before we get there, we want the statistics, ethnic balance. By the way, it's a matter in the Constitution. We want to know, of the 42, 43 communities, what percentage did the people in Embu, in Manyatta get? And you will be amazed. And when I dealt with the conflict in Rwanda after the genocide, in fact, the problem in Rwanda and Burundi is basically this. 84% of the population are Hutus in both countries, and 14% are Tutsis in both countries. At some stage, the whole leadership of Burundi, from the president to deputy speaker, were eliminated because they went through a hugely successful election where, if it is the majority must have their way and the minority have their say, that happened. But people were hurting. And what happened? Killings. So, in my view, if you disturb the army, if you do not have a professional military in Kenya or anywhere in the region, ladies and gentlemen, you do not have a country. Please, you can take that one to the bank, even if it is a hustler bank. You cannot disturb if you, and the reason our military men and women have done very well in terms of peacekeeping everywhere, right? It's because we have had a professional army. But if we have a tribalized army, and I still insist, I want you guys, if the parliament, I'm told when you people in Kenya Kwanza went to State House and complained to President Ruto that amwezi kwenda nyumbani wananjwa na pigia kelele because of taxation, he looked at you and told you, but you are the ones in parliament. Nyinyi ndio mempitisha the Finance Act. So you now have to play your role. If you're going to do oversighting of this government, and I like the young parliamentarians, actually went in at 30, and I remained there. Yes, I think I should have been your member. Now I'll do the mentoring that our wonderful Mheshimiwa was talking about. I must conclude, ladies and gentlemen, before I invite our brother to come and make his remarks, and close this consultative session. You know, we went to Bomas because Kenyans lost their lives. Kenyans, some of them wearing sufurias, right? Let's not forget we buried nearly 70 people. Let's not forget a lot of them had their households and everything they owned destroyed. And even as recent as 2 weeks ago, 25,000 people in Mavoko had what they call their homes destroyed. And we hear you friends in Kenya Kwanza telling us affordable housing. What the fellows have put together what they could afford and you destroy it, and you are telling them affordable housing? So, ladies and gentlemen, we cannot hope to transform our nation, indeed any nation, without meaningful dialogue, and that is built on mutual trust and confidence. Nonetheless, I've observed that during our 73 days, we've already done 73 days of the national dialogue, goodwill has occurred, and both sides have learned to respect one another's points of view. Therefore, I must congratulate my friend, my co-chair, Kimani Chungwa. When he came in, I told Kimani, I looked at him, I said, listen, you are young, I think you're very young, and the future is ahead of you. Me, I can go back to Sekuru, right, and forget about you guys. But if you don't succeed at these talks, history will judge you badly. And we must therefore confront the truth and nothing but the truth. Our forefathers, the likes of Mzee Jomo Kenyatta and Jaramogi Oginga Odinga, were able to negotiate and compromise even with the British colonialists. When Mzee Jaramogi Oginga Odinga said, without Jomo Kenyatta, there will be no freedom. Now, we should emulate them. 26 years ago, the late President Daniel Arap Moi's ruling party, KANU, by the way, KANU was organizing secretary for 12 good years. I was elected national organizing secretary the same day with the late Moses Mundamba Mudavadi, Wycliffe's father. So you can see if Mudavadi is beginning to look old. I started it with his old, late father. That is a beauty when you are young. You see it all. And I therefore can pass this information, this wisdom, sometimes lack of it, depending on how you look at it, to the younger leaders. Mzee Moi then was able to accommodate dialogue. After the violence that followed 2007 elections and almost tore our nation apart, Mzee Kibaki, our brother Raila, and indeed myself, with our respective coalitions, were able to come together and work on creating a durable new constitution. Our history is replete with examples of transformative national dialogue for the betterment of all Kenyans. We at Azimio la Umoja One Kenya Alliance Coalition remain optimistic that these bipartisan talks, which should conclude with a report handed to both my friend William Ruto and my brother here on November 22nd. We are very clear. We don't want to stay there for longer than is necessary. And some of them say we are paid huge sums of money. I've not seen a cent. I'm giving my time and my everything to my country so that these things can succeed. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my great pleasure to invite my brother and actually a soulmate, the Right Honorable Raila Amolo Odinga, to come make his remarks and close this session. Well, we thank our partners, really. You know, Jama, you Kenyans may not know, CD1, the diplomatic corps, the number one, and to get number one CD, diplomatic corps, number one, means a lot.